Hello, my name is Jan Hewitt. I am a regulatory counsel in the Policy Office, which is in the Office of Scientific Investigations, or OSI, under the Office of Compliance within the Center for Drug Evaluation and Research at the FDA. Among other bioresearch monitoring objectives, the Policy Office is responsible for assisting OSI's sub-offices by providing strategic advice and legal analysis, facilitating development and resolution of CDA drug-related compliance cases, including clinicaltrials.gov noncompliance. My goal here is to provide you with an understanding of the clinicaltrials.gov definitions, laws, and regulations. As noted in part one of this SBIA three-part series on clinicaltrials.gov, presented by Mia Zhang, clinicaltrials.gov include not only clinical trials involving investigational drugs, but also biologic and device products. Here in this presentation, I will be focusing on CDA's role in clinicaltrials.gov involving drug products. Before we dive into the presentation, I have a knowledge check question for you. Who is responsible for clinicaltrials.gov registration and results information submission? Is it A, the sponsor, B, the principal investigator of an investigator-initiated study, C, the individual designated by a sponsor, grantee, contractor, or awardee, or D, all of the above? And the answer is all of the above. So let's start with some of the key definitions related to the requirements for clinicaltrials.gov. First, an applicable drug clinical trial is defined as a controlled clinical investigation, other than phase one, of any FDA-regulated drug or biological product for any disease or condition. The final rule considers all interventional clinical trials with one or more arms and with one or more pre-specified outcome measures to be controlled clinical trials for purposes of the clinicaltrials.gov requirement. So while we may not consider an open-label, single-arm safety study to be a controlled clinical trial, if there are pre-specified outcome measures, then for the purposes of registration and submission of results, it is a controlled clinical trial. Another key term is responsible party, or RP. This is the person or entity directly responsible for complying with the clinicaltrials.gov requirement. The responsible party is almost always the sponsor of the study. However, the sponsor may designate a principal investigator as the responsible party if the principal investigator is responsible for conducting the trial, has access to and control over the data from the clinical trial, has the right to publish the results of the trial, and has the ability to meet all of the requirements for the submission of clinical trial information. I would like to highlight that if you have an applicable clinical trial with an investigational new drug application and for which there is a sponsor investigator, then the sponsor of that IND should also be named as a sponsor on clinicaltrials.gov. Additional definitions include control or controlled, which means a clinical study that includes a comparison group. The comparison group receives a placebo, or in another treatment, or no treatment at all. Primary or secondary outcome data is collected concurrently or non-concurrently and then compared. The controlled clinical trial can be one or more arms, and there are pre-specified outcome measures. It is important to note that for single-arm studies to be controlled, the data can be obtained, for example, from historical controls or a subject's own baseline data. Primary completion date or completion date. These are interchangeable terms under the final rule. The primary completion date is an important definition for purposes of meeting submission of results information timing requirements. The final rule defines the primary completion date as the date the final subject was examined or received an intervention for purposes of final collection of data for the primary outcome measure. Responsible parties may submit, initially, an estimated primary completion date, but when the study is completed, the responsible party should revise this status to actual primary completion date. For purposes of when results for the applicable clinical trial are to be submitted under 42 CFR 11, The general or standard submission deadline is no later than 1 year after the primary completion date of the applicable clinical trial. Moving along to what the Food and Drug Administration's role is related to clinicaltrials.gov. First, starting with the informed consent statement regarding clinicaltrials.gov. Section 801 of the Food and Drug Administration Amendments Act, or FDAR, added a requirement that informed consent documents for applicable clinical trial must include a specific statement as shown on this slide. The regulation does not specify, nor does it require, the informed consent statement to appear in a specific section of the informed consent. The next requirement is a certification of compliance with clinicaltrials.gov requirement. As required in Section 801 of FDAR, a certification must accompany certain applications and submissions to FDA, stating that all applicable requirements related to clinicaltrials.gov registration and result information submission requirements have been met. Where applicable, that certification should include the appropriate national clinical trial or NCT control number or numbers to be able to easily reference a study or studies on clinicaltrials.gov. FDA created a certification form, Form FDA 3674, with instruction that can be used to satisfy the certification of compliance requirement. Certification can be included in a variety of submission types, for example, original INDs or new protocols added to an IND, NDAs, BLAs, as well as efficacy supplements, ANDAs, and certain device submissions. Updates to the certification form may include adding new NCT numbers and changing any key required information. For those of you unfamiliar with the form FDA 3674, FDA published a final guidance titled Form FDA 3674, Certification to Accompany Drug, Biological Product, and Device Applications and Submissions in June 2017. I would encourage you to review this guidance. FDA also has compliance oversight responsibilities with the registration, submission of results information, and update to the record in clinicaltrials.gov. Subpart B of the final rule, section titled Registration, describes the requirements of when an ACT is to be registered, which is within 3 weeks of enrolling the first human subject. In addition, the International Committee of Medical Journal Editors, or ICMJE, requires trial registration as a condition of the publication of research results generated by the clinical trial. The main purpose of registering clinical trials is to provide information to potential participants and referring physicians. As Mia mentioned in part one of this three-part presentation, responsible parties use a web-based data entry system for both registration and results reporting called the Protocol Registration and Results System, or PRS. As you can see on the slide, I've included some, not all, of the required data elements when registering a clinical trial. For example, the study title, the primary disease or condition being studied, interventions and controls, recruitment information, where the study is going to be conducted, and the contact information for those sites. After the registration information is submitted, the NLM will conduct a quality control review of the information before it is published on clinicaltrials.gov to identify any apparent errors, deficiencies, or inconsistencies. Responsible parties are also required to submit certain results information to the clinicaltrials.gov registry. As with the registration requirements, in addition to the FDA requirements for ACTs, other bodies, for example, the ICMJE, will also require trials result submissions as a condition of the publication of the clinical trial research results. As described in subpart C, results information submission of the final rule, responsible parties for applicable clinical trials subject to the final rule requirements are required to submit results information depending on whether the primary completion date for the study was before or after January 18, 2017, when the final rule, 42 CFR Part 11, went into effect. As mentioned earlier, the standard submission deadline is 1 year after the primary completion date of the study, where the primary completion date is defined as the date that the final study participant was examined or received an intervention for purposes of the final collection of data for the primary outcome. If other required information has not been collected by that time, for example, if there are long-term adverse event results being collected well past the primary completion date, partial results should be submitted and the remaining clinical trial information submitted when ready. There are opportunities to delay the submission or results information. However, these requests must be made before the standard submission deadline. First, a certification for delayed submission. A certification for delay pushes back result submission until 30 days after FDA approval of the drug for the use studied in the ACT or after the marketing application is withdrawn without resubmission for at least 210 days, whichever is first, or 2 years after the date the certification is submitted, if none of those apply. Second, extension requests for good cause. A responsible party may also submit an extension for good cause, which describes the reasons why the results cannot be provided according to the deadline. Lastly, a waiver of the requirements for submission of results information. Here, an responsible party may submit a request to waive any of the applicable requirements of subpart C for the final rule. The request must contain certain elements, for example, the NCT number, the title, the name of the sponsor, and so forth. But as noted in section 1154, there must be a description of the extraordinary circumstances that the responsible party believes justifies the waiver and an explanation of why granting the request would be consistent with the protection of public health or in the interest of national security. Section 1148 of the final rule also describes the format requirements of results data. Specifically, submission of data must be in a tabular format summarizing participant flow, demographic and baseline characteristics of participants, primary and secondary outcomes, as well as results of any scientifically appropriate statistical test and adverse event information. In addition, the rule requires the submission of the full protocol and statistical analysis plan. Again, the National Library of Medicine will conduct a quality control review of this data. The focus here is to ensure all data elements are provided, they have face, validity, and internal consistency, and that the formatting is correct. The quality control review process takes up to 30 days, and if there are errors or problems, the responsible party will be asked to correct those, and then the results will be posted. Subpart D of the final rule describes the requirements for when the clinicaltrials.gov record must be updated. In general, any change to the record must be updated not less than once every 12 months. Other study data elements require an update within 30 days of any change. For example, recruitment status, study start date, expanded access availability of the product, and so forth. It is particularly important to make sure contact information, for example, names of responsible parties and sponsors, if they have changed, are correct and updated in a timely fashion. Finally, I will briefly touch on the prohibited acts under the Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act for clinicaltrials.gov. Subpart E of the final rule describes the actions FDA can take for failure to comply with the requirements. Here, I've listed the three prohibited acts under the Food and Drug Cosmetic Act. Specifically, failing to submit a certification of compliance or knowingly submitting a false certification required by Section 402J of the Public Health Service Act, failing to submit clinical trial information as required by the 402J of the PHS Act, for example, failing to register or failing to submit results information or failing to update the clinicaltrials.gov record, and lastly, under the same section of the PHS Act, submitting clinical trial information that is false or misleading. So as I've come to the end of my presentation, I would like to leave you with some key messages. Each of these messages are directed towards responsible parties and those of you who assist them with their applicable clinical trial. It is very important to be aware of and comply with all of the clinicaltrials.gov requirements. I hope this presentation and those of my colleagues, Mia Jung and Rochelle Swan, will be helpful as you navigate your roles related to clinicaltrials.gov. Thank you.